Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you out here this morning. I welcome you here. I hope we can learn something from Scripture this morning, and we can also praise God together. This is the one opportunity that we have during the week to come together and worship as a group. It is one of those opportunities. And as Psalm 122 says, I rejoiced with those who said to me, let us go up to the house of the Lord. And that's what we're doing here this morning. As there's more people coming in, let's just go into the bulletin a little bit and see what's going on through the week. And for today, 2 p.m., we've got junior youth at the lake. And they're saying meet at the church at 2. Rides will be available for those who don't have a ride down to the lake. And also, please send life jackets if your kids don't know how to swim or are not good swimmers. Snack will be sold. And plan to be back around 5. Okay, that's for the junior youth today. And Tuesday from 1 to 5, we've got quilting at the retirement home from 1 to 5. And it's also saying, please bring FOSPA. And also Tuesday, 7:30 in the evening, is ladies' election meeting at the church, starting at 7:30. And because there's ladies' meeting on Tuesday, there will be no German outreach Bible study this week. So remember that. Du wart nicht deutsche Bibelstunde. Diese Dienstag sein, weil der ladies' meeting wird hier in der Kirche zu Hause sein. So, du wart nicht deutsche Bibelstunde sein. And also, the worship committee is looking for volunteers willing to lead praise and worship night on November 12th. Please talk to the worship committee, Stuart, Lindsay, or Angie, if you're interested in this. And for the youth announcements, Wednesday night youth Bible study at 7:30 at Benatina's house around the bonfire. Bring a chair and Bible. And young adults will be at Abe and Esther's at 8. Also, there's an opportunity to join a Christmas choir. And if you would like to join a Christmas choir this year, there will be a meeting right after church here in the sanctuary for those who are interested. So if you're interested in joining the Christmas choir this year, please stay back after the church service. Also, congratulations to Daniel Weeb and Casey Friesen. They plan to be married on October 14. If anyone knows of any legal or ethical reason why the two should not be married, contact Pastor Henry Jansen. In the meantime, let's pray for them as they prepare for this special day in their union together. Is there anything that I've missed that I need to report? If not, let's open in prayer this morning before the worship team comes up and leads us in worship. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you for this beautiful morning. Thank you for your love. I thank you for your presence here. I thank you for this opportunity you've given us to gather together as a group and worship you, and also to gather together as a group to learn from you. May our hearts be open to you this morning. And Lord, as we hear of all things on the news of wars and things like that, we are blessed to be in a place that is not affected by it. Lord, I pray that we would remember this and not take this for granted, that of the blessings you've given us. And Lord, as we continue this worship service, we pray for the churches around us who are also gathering to worship you. And Lord, I pray that your name would be truly glorified and praised through this day. Praise your name. Amen.
Thank you. Good morning. Why am I here this morning? Why are you here this morning? But I'm Zavi here for the Osmaris too. Why am I here to worship him? Because I feel like it. It's nice if we feel like it, but often we worship him even though we don't feel like it, because he is worthy of it. How great is our God?
He wraps himself in thy and our
Next one, we'll be singing in Low German, Cornerstone. If it's suitable, I would ask that the congregation would rise for the next few songs. If it doesn't suit, it's okay. Eichenstein. Harry war alles, und wir sind dort in der Natur, und wir sind dort in Dinge, wo du rangehst, wir weiten dort. Hei as, der Harry war alles. Hei kon der Harry sein, er war alles. Ob es hei der Harry ist, er war dien in mein Leben. Dort lad er uns will. At Calvary.
Crucified, knowing not it was for me he died. On Calvary.
Thank you, worship team, for leading us in worship. I'd like to dismiss the children for Children's Church. If your age is 2 to 4, and if you don't know where to go, there'll be somebody in the back there to help you. Ushers, could we get ready for the offering? Let's ask God's blessing on the offering before we take it. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you for the blessings you've given us. Thank you for providing for us. And thank you for giving us the responsibility to deal with the possessions you've given us. And as we give back to the blessings you have bestowed on us, I pray that your name would be glorified and that those who are recipients or the ministries that it goes to, Lord, I pray that your name would be glorified through it and that your creation would be blessed by it. Praise your name. Thanks for the gifts. Pastor Henry, it's your turn. May God bless you as you speak to us.
Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Am I on here? Should I use this other mic? All right. He's almost has it figured out. There we go. All right. Good morning. It is good to be here this morning. And it is good to see all of you here this morning. It is a blessed morning. It is a little cooler this morning than it has been the last few days. So that is lovely to have a cooler morning. I enjoy the cooler weather. So as they get the sound figured out there, let's bow our head for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you, and God, we thank you for a beautiful morning. We thank you that your love is new every morning, your grace is new every morning. And Father, we thank you so much that that you gave us breath this morning again. And Father, this morning as we have worshiped and praised you already, and we want to now look into your word, Lord, I pray that you will continue to be glorified. And Father, I pray that we will receive a blessing and that we will learn from your word. And Father, I pray that we would put it to practice. So Lord, may you be glorified here this morning, and may we receive a blessing from you, Father. I thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right. Mine? I had it muted. Sorry. Sorry. Here I thought they were the problem and I was the problem. I'm sorry about that. All right. So this will work better now. That's what we do. We look at the next people and we blame them, right? And sometimes we need a mirror. So I feel a bit silly about that this morning, but that's okay. This morning we're going to continue in the book of James, and it's been a while back since I talked about it. We've went through James chapter 1 and 2, and just a brief overview of what we have talked about so far was in James chapter 1, we looked at testing and persevering, the first half of the chapter, and then the second half of the chapter we looked at hearing and doing, how just hearing the word isn't good enough. We need to do what we hear. We need to put it to practice. And then in chapter 2, we saw that there is no favoritism in Christ. And the first half of the chapter, and then the last half of the chapter, we looked at faith and works, where James says, if you have faith but have no works, then you have dead faith, and your faith isn't alive. So, and today we're going to look at chapter 3 and chapter 4, so we have a lot that I want to cover today. So I will be doing, well, I'll read through two chapters, and they're pretty self-explanatory. They speak on their own. The Word of God does that very well. It speaks on its own. So I'll just do a brief overview in German as to what we're going to be talking about. Wir wollen von der Wahrheit wiedergehen in Jakobus Kapitel 3, wo wir von der Kirche 3 in Feuer. Und wir haben bei so weit, haben wir Kapitel 1, diese Kirche genannt, wo wir waren auf der Probierstalt, testing and persevering auf der Probierstalt, und wo wir stark blieben, wo wir wussten dort an. Und dann der zweite Half, oder der letzte Half von Jakobus Kapitel 1, da hier wir von Hirn in Down. Dort halbt uns nicht, nicht bloß das Wort Gottes hier, wenn wir dort nicht ausleben dürfen. Und dann in Kapitel 2, diese kickt wie nennen, sah in der ersten Half, dass es kein Favoritism in Christus. In Christus sind wir alle über rein. Und wir sollen andere Menschen nicht favoren, einer über den anderen, wegen Christus, der da dort nicht. Christus, der sagt, wir sind alle in sein Ebenbild gemerkt. Wir sind alle so aus Christus gemerkt. Und so, wir sollen dort nicht denken, dass wir ein Hoch heben und den anderen leer stampeln. Und an der letzte Half von Kapitel 2, diese sah wie dort der Glauben und Worten, der ist dort. Wenn du sagst, dass du hast Glauben und deine Worten bewiesen dort nicht, dann ist dein Glauben dort. So ein Glauben ist dort der Haupt nicht. Und von der, weil wir Kapitel 3 in Feuer kicken, und hier ist er redet dort von Reden und Pochen. So, das redet sehr viel von der Tung. Mit der Tung, da wir pochen, wir reden, und wir haben Leben und Doubt in sich. Und so, wir waren diese von der Nantchen. Und ich wollte die Farschen hier so weiter anhören, ab der Deutsch, auch ab Englisch. Und mir fällt dort Plattdeutsch lesen sehr schwer. So, ich wollte bloß ab Hochdeutsch lesen. Und von der von jemand, was dort kann, ferner Plattdeutsch lesen, kann wahrlich Plattdeutsch lesen. Und Plattdeutsch oder Hochdeutsch, was immer jemand das leichteste ist. So, wir haben ein Teil zu covern von der, so ich will kurz damit anfangen. So, we do have a lot of ground that we want to cover today. Like I said, we want to cover two chapters today. And chapter 3 and 4 talks about speaking and boasting. And we all know that that words carry a lot of weight. We speak with our words, we can speak life or death. And we see that in Genesis, that God literally spoke this universe into existence. So we know that words carry a lot of weight, and we know that words are incredibly powerful. They carry in them both life and death. And we very often don't realize that by the words that we speak them so loosely, so that we don't really listen to, or we don't think before we speak very often, or at least I do. You probably don't do that as much, but I do. I very often speak without thinking, and then later on, I really wish I could backtrack and not say what I have said, or at least change the way I had said it. But once the words are out, they are gone. They are out. So we see, like I said, in Genesis, that God created this world simply by speaking. And Psalm 33, verse 9 says, "For he spoke and it came to be. He commanded and it stood firm." So words are powerful, they are meaning. An ill-timed or a perfectly timed word spoken to another can impact their entire life. Have you ever thought of that? The words that we speak, they can impact someone's entire life. So let's think about that as we go through this here today. I will start reading James chapter 3. I'll read the first two verses, and then I will speak on that here a little bit. Chapter 3, verse 1. "Not many of you should become teachers, my fellow believers, because you know that we who teach will be judged more strictly. We all stumble in many ways. Anyone who is never at fault in what they say is perfect, able to keep their whole body in check." Now he starts out by saying that not many of you should become teachers, because he says that you know that we will be judged more strictly. And I found that encouraging. He says that we, he uses the word we. He includes himself in this as well. So that tells me that that Brother James also had a human nature, that he sometimes spoke things that he probably didn't want to say, and he sometimes let his words fly a little loose, and later on he regretted it. And he says that not many of you should become teachers. And, you know, as teachers, as pastors, that is our main way of how we do things. It's by our communicating, by speaking. And he says, you know, we know that we will be judged more strictly. And I imagine that this was heavy on his heart, because he when he spoke, he knew that God was going to hold him accountable for what he spoke. And he was the half-brother of Jesus. Maybe Jesus reminded him of that. Now, I'm just reading into this. This is not in the Bible, what I'm going to say now. But maybe James and Jesus, as they were growing up and as they were going into their adult years, maybe Jesus reminded him more often, "James, don't say that. James, don't say it that way. James, watch out what you're saying." Maybe Jesus reminded him more often. They were brothers. I don't know that. But it's about two-thirds of the book of James that talks about words. So I found that interesting. So it obviously was heavy on his heart, the words that we speak. So, but then he goes right into verse 2, and he says, "We all stumble in many ways." And again, he says, "We all." He doesn't say, "You all stumble." He includes himself. He says, "We all stumble in many ways." And he says, if anyone is able to never say anything wrong, if you can always say, if you're never at fault with what you're speaking, then you have your whole body in check. He says, then you're perfect. But he realizes that that's not, that's hard. That's humanly impossible. And then he goes into verse 3 and 5, and he uses some examples here. Let's read verse 3 through 5. He says, "When we put bits into the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we can turn the whole animal. Or take ships as an example. Although they are large and are driven by strong winds, they are steered by a very small rudder wherever the pilot wants to go. Likewise, the tongue is a small part of the body, but it makes great boasts. Consider what a great forest is set on fire by a small spark." Now here he's using small things as an example by comparison. So he says, just consider a horse. And there's many horsemen here in our congregation, and I'm sure you know this. When you have a wild horse and you put a bit in a horse's mouth, you can turn the whole animal. And the bit that you put into a horse's mouth, it's just a small piece of metal. If you compare that to the size of a horse, you can control the whole horse just by that little bit. And also he says, now consider a ship. Now, I don't know if some of you have been on a cruise ship. I never have. I've been on fairly large boats, I think, but I've never been on a large ship. And he says, a ship, it's driven by strong winds, but it's controlled by a small rudder wherever the pilot desires to go. And then he uses another example. He says, a small spark can set a great forest on fire. And I know this from where we used to live, from in Alberta. When it was really dry, we weren't even allowed to ride our four-wheelers, our ATVs, through fences and on the hills there, because just the spark that might possibly come out of your exhaust could set a whole forest on fire. So, and he says, that is how your tongue is. He says, the words that you speak, they are that strong. And we may think, well, what is the big deal about this? Let's read verse 6. And verse 6 has a lot in it. It says, the tongue also is a fire, a world of evil among the parts of the body. It corrupts the whole body. It sets the whole course of one's life on fire and is itself set on fire by hell. Wow. There is so much in this verse. He says, your tongue is a fire. And he says, it's a world of evil among the parts of the body. And he says, it corrupts the whole body. By your tongue, it can corrupt the whole body. He says, it can set the whole course of your life on fire. He says it is set on fire by hell itself, your tongue. Wenn wir uns dumm ein bisschen anlösen, was first saß hier sein, dass wo viel Kraft an der Tongue hat, die sagt, in der Tongue ist Salz vier. Die sagt, da kann den ganzen Körper vernichten, kann den ganzen Leben vernichten, bloß in der Tongue allein. That is a pretty intimidating list there. James is making his point very clear. He says, watch what you're saying. You carry a lot of weight by your tongue. And this week as I was studying into this, it made me not want to come up here anymore. It makes me not want to speak anymore. Because our words, our tongue, carries a lot of weight. And I don't know about the rest of you, but I have a weakness, and I will confess to that. I have a weakness when someone comes to me and they speak ill of someone. I am either quiet or I go along with what they're saying. And that is a sin. And that is a weakness that I have. And I have asked the Lord multiple times, numerous times, please don't allow me to do that anymore. I don't want to go along when someone speaks ill of someone else. Even if it may be true, I don't want to just follow along with that. Because what I'm doing with that is I'm judging that other person, and we will go into that here a bit later on. And that is wrong of me. So I confess, if I have ever done that with you, please forgive me. If I've ever done that of you and you know of it, come and talk to me. I do want to make that right. I don't want to do that. And hold me accountable. I don't want to do that anymore. Our words, they carry so much weight. It is unreal. Let's read from verse 7 through 12. It says, all kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, sea creatures are being tamed and have been tamed by mankind. But no human being can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil full of deadly poison. With the tongue we praise our Lord and Father, and with it we curse human beings who have been made in God's likeness. Out of the same mouth come praise and cursings. My brothers and sisters, this should not be. Can fresh water and salt water flow from the same spring? My brothers and sisters, can a fig tree bear olives or a grapevine bear figs? Neither can a salt spring produce fresh water. Now again, he continues with this. He says that mankind can tame all kinds of animals, and we've seen this. You can tame a jaguar, you can tame a monkey, you can tame birds. We can do all of that. And he says no one can tame the tongue. He says it's a restless evil. That little thing that flaps in my mouth when I'm talking, he says it's a restless evil. It's full of deadly poison. Verse 9 and 10, he says, with it we bless our Lord and Father, and with it we curse people that are made in the likeness of God. And how often do that? We get together here and we praise our Lord and God, and then we go out and we curse people that are made in the image of God. I am guilty of that, and I'm sure that I'm not the only one. He says, this should not be. We should not do that. When we curse others and then we sing praises out of the same mouth, we are sending the wrong message to people that are watching us. We profess to be Christ followers, and I truly believe that all of us that are here and that are hearing my voice desire to be that. But then we lose our temper over small little things, and we say things that we shouldn't say. Let's read further. I'm not going to speak a whole lot on some of this stuff because I think it speaks so well for itself. Verse 13, who is wise and understanding among you? Let them show it by their good life, by deeds done in humility that comes from wisdom. But if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your heart, do not boast about it or deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from heaven, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder and every evil practice. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace reap a harvest of righteousness. Let's continue on in chapter 4. What causes fights and quarrels among you? Do they not come from your desire that battles within you? You desire, but you do not have, so you kill. You covet, but you cannot get what you want, so you quarrel and fight. You do not have because you do not ask God. When you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity against God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Or do you think that Scripture says without reason that he jealously longs for the Spirit that he caused to dwell in us? But he gives us more grace. The Scripture says, God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. Submit yourselves, then, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning, and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up. Now that is a whole lot that we can learn from that. And as I was reading this over, I've read it over I don't know how many times this week. It almost seemed like James was frustrated. It almost seems to me that he says, people, wake up. You're living too carelessly. You're speaking too carelessly. He says, wake up, people. Your words matter. And he says, how can we get away from this wickedness? How can we do this? He says, by humbling yourself. He says, humble yourself before the Lord, and he will exalt you. See, most of us, we boast because there is something lacking inside of us, whatever that may be, but we talk bigger than we are. We want to be recognized. We want to be heard. So we boast. Verse 11 and 12. Brothers and sisters, do not slander one another. Anyone who speaks against a brother or a sister or judges them speaks against the law and judges it. When you judge the law, you are not keeping it, but sitting in judgment on it. There is only one lawgiver and judge, the one who is able to save and destroy. But you, who are you to judge your neighbor? This is what I was talking about before. When someone is tearing another person down, and we just go with the flow, we just be reden bliss mat. Says, who are you to judge? Well, they said this or that, they did this or that. Says, who are you? Who do you think you are to judge a brother or sister? There is only one lawgiver and judge, and that is the one that who can save or destroy. So is he saying here that we don't need to hold someone accountable? It's not what he's saying. He says, when you know that the Bible makes it clear that if you see someone sin, go and confront them, go talk to them. Don't go behind their back and talk bad about them or make it even worse than it is. And these verses remind me of what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7, verse 1 and 2. It says, do not judge, or you too will be judged. For the same way that you judge others, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. God is the only one that can judge our true motives. He knows what we feel, what we think. Now, when we read a portion of scripture like this, it is very easy to look at someone else and see their faults and hear the things that they have said. Just like before, I had it muted here and I was looking up there like, get it figured out. And it was my fault that it wasn't working. But we do the same thing with people all the time. We hear every mistake that someone else is making, and we don't think about the mistakes that we're making very often. And very often in a meeting, things get said that later on we wish, man, I wish I could backtrack and not say what I said. It is wise to think things through before we speak. Verse 7, he says, that we have to resist the devil and we have to resist the temptation to speak with him, to speak along with the devil. And just an example that I want to give you on how powerful our words are, something that happened to me this week. I came home one evening from work and I had an idea. I had this idea for a little bit already before I went home, and I walk into the door and I said, hey, let's go to town. Let's jump in the pickup and let's go to town. And one of my children was so excited. Said, let's go. And then Sarah and I were talking a little bit, and then, oh, it doesn't work. Like, I hadn't thought things through. I just, as I was thinking, I said, let's go. And my child was so excited about this. And within 5 minutes, I had this child so excited, and I had crushed that child's spirit. Because I said, no, we can't go after all. And my child said stuff to me that hurt me a little bit. said, you always do that, Dad. You get us so excited and then you don't do it. You know, that stung a little bit, but my child was right. I do that. And later on, me and my child, we could have a conversation about that. And I had to apologize for my behavior, for my words, that I speak so easily. And my child apologized to me for lashing out at me. We could have just walked away from there. I could have just walked away and I could have scolded my child for speaking that way to me, and I could have just walked away from there, and my child would continue to believe, Dad, you always do that. You promise and then you don't follow through with that. And I have been guilty in that so many times. And sometimes God speaks through a little child, through our children. He will tell us stuff that we as parents don't necessarily want to hear. But those are reminders of how when we speak. And the younger the child is, they take the words literal that we speak. When I came home and I said, let's go to town, my child thought that in a couple of minutes we're all going to be in a pickup and we're going to be going to town. It didn't happen. Weigh your words carefully, church. Valve alle apposten, wo wir reden und wort wir sagen, wegen unser wir die drehen und doil weg. Verse 13 through 17. Now listen, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business and make money. Why, you do not even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogant schemes. All such boasting is evil. If anyone then knows the good they ought to do and doesn't do it, it is sin for them. Now, how often do we do this? Just like James says here. He says, so often we plan. We already have our vacation planned for next year. Next year, we're going to go to Cancun. We're going to go to Canada, to the States, wherever. And we plan as if we can make things happen by our words. But then Paul says, who are you? You appear for a little while and then you vanish. He says, we should instead, if it is the Lord's will, then we will do this or that. We need to keep the Lord in mind with this. We need to make sure that the Bible teaches that to know the Lord's will, and then whatever we ask, we shall receive. But very often, we just ask, like I read earlier, and we don't receive because we want to use it for our selfish reasons. We are but a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. Some of you that are a little older, you say that life goes by so quick. Before you know it, you're 70, 80. And to me, I'm pushing 50. It seems like, man, just yesterday I was 20. And the older you get, the quicker the years go by. And we plan for great things. And I'm not saying that we shouldn't plan ahead. We should. We should plan ahead, but we should keep the Lord involved with that. If it is the Lord's will, we want to do this and we want to do that. We don't know what tomorrow brings, but God does. He watches over us from morning to evening, according to Psalm 121. And his mercy and kindness are fresh every morning. So the Bible has a lot to say about how we should speak, what we should say, and what we shouldn't say. So if we spend more time in the Word of God and less time on social media, less time in unnecessary things, but more time in the Word of God, we can learn how to speak what we should and what we shouldn't say. And in just one chapter alone, I want to take a few gold nuggets out of this. And this is Proverbs chapter 18. There is a number of gold nuggets in here. And verse 2 says, A fool takes no pleasure in understanding, but only in expressing his opinion. And then verse 6 says, A fool's lips walk into a fight, and his mouth invites a beating. How truth isn't that? If foolishness we're just talking about, it very easily gets us into fight. And it says the mouth invites a beating. Verse 7 says, a fool's mouth is his ruin, and his lips are a snare to his soul. And verse 20, from the fruit of a man's mouth, his stomach is satisfied. He is satisfied by the yield of his lips. Verse 21, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. So in closing here, I want to just encourage all of us this coming week, let's be more intentional about what we speak. Let's think about this before we just let the words come out of our mouth. Before you speak, ask yourself if what you're about to say is kind, necessary, and true. And if you cannot say yes to all three of those, then perhaps hold your tongue. So again, before you speak, ask yourself if what you're about to say is kind, necessary, and true. And if you cannot say yes to all three of those, then don't say it. And I know that takes some practice, that takes some doing. A saying that my dad has told me many times, or a little story, he said that before you speak, always think three times. And he had it in a little story where this one man had told his son that "Dau ema dreimal denken før du reden des." And then one day they're walking down the road, and his dad, he's walking right behind his dad, and he's saying, "Dad, I'm thinking. Dad, I'm thinking. Dad, I'm thinking that your coat is on fire." So there is a time to speak up right away, right? But he had taught his son, don't just blurt it out. And that is something that we should all, that I want to learn and that I'm continuously practicing. Don't just speak. Think about what you're going to speak, because the words that come out of your mouth, they are either life or death. We speak cursings and blessings with the same mouth. Let's be encouraged. We have a whole Bible where we can learn from. We have the Holy Spirit that will cause us to remember, that will teach us, that will guide us into all truth. But instead of allowing the human nature, the sinful nature to speak up, when we are frustrated and we want to do that, let's bring that to the cross, repent of that, and leave that there, and then take on the new identity in Christ. And allow the Spirit that is within us to speak. Let's close with a word of prayer. And worship team, would you come up? Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your word. God, I am so very grateful that we have your word with us. We can learn so much from it. And we have your Spirit. Father, you yourself are with us through your Holy Spirit. And I thank you for that. And I thank you for each one that is here this morning. I thank you that we have learned. And Father, I pray that these coming days that we would be more intentional about the words that we speak, and that we would not let the sinful nature to come out. And if we see someone else do that, that we would be gracious, and that we would pray for them instead of just beating them down. Father, I pray that your grace will continue to be with us. And I thank you that it is new every morning. I thank you for each one that came out this morning. And I pray that your Spirit will walk with us. Would you protect us? Would you guide us throughout this day today and throughout the coming days and weeks to come? So, Father, I thank you and I praise you in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
For whatever your heart is full of will come out of your mouth. So, Father God, as we go from here, it is our prayer that we will let you create in us a clean heart.
May that be all of our prayers. Create in me a clean heart, O Lord. So very true what Brother Pete said here. What our heart is full, our mouth will speak. Wat ons hart vol van is, dat wou wie van reden. Man, wie ons hart waren fallen van zien woord, dat wou wie van dort reden. So, mocht de Heer jen zegenen. May the Lord bless you throughout this week and until we see us again. The Lord bless you. We zijn dismissed.